Welcome to PayPod, the show that features thought-provoking interviews with leaders and entrepreneurs in the payments and financial technology industries. From credit card processing to Bitcoin, we cover it all. So if you want to know what's happening right now in the payments industry, stay tuned. Now, here's your host, Scott Hawksworth.
Hey everyone out there in the world of payments and fintech, Scott back with you, serving up another episode of PayPod, the payments podcast. This week we are diving into a topic that anyone who is running or working for an ISO, a merchant acquirer, or really any business would do well to consider. And that's the power of business support for technology. When you're offering merchant account services, there are so many factors at play. There's your value proposition to the merchants. There's the challenges with managing merchants running all kinds of businesses. There's the technology aspect as retail businesses work with POS systems and more. There's the technology aspect as online businesses work with payment gateways, integrations, and all of that. Meanwhile, the merchants all have to focus on delivering a great experience for their customers and keeping their businesses running smoothly. It's a lot to manage. It's a lot to keep track of. And our guest this episode comes from a company called Boomtown, which is helping technology organizations deliver better customer experiences top to bottom. They are helping businesses solve these challenges. So needless to say, he's a fantastic person to be discussing all of this with. So without further ado, I'm pleased to introduce Tyler Gerber, who is the Director of Strategic Accounts at Boomtown. Tyler, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Scott. Thanks for having me.
To start us off, can you tell us just a little bit about your career and how you ended up at Boomtown and what you're doing for them?
Yeah, definitely. Well, you know, like many I've spoke with over the years, I kind of fell into payments. And, you know, I originally started my career in advertising, running campaigns for large pharmaceutical and healthcare companies. I mean, it was great. Spent a few years in LA, relocated to New York, and then another additional 4 years at an agency in New York, which was a great foundation and eventually led me to a great friend of mine, Giuseppe, introducing me to Chip, which is Boomtown's founder and CEO. Boomtown launched and incorporated in 2013, launched the website in 2014, and like most others at early stage companies, I've done almost every job imaginable. So I've helped pull together the structure and copy of one of the first few iterations of our website. There was one Thanksgiving or Christmas where we focused on building our network of technicians. I'm pretty sure I had to have vetted over 2,000 resumes or applications, and you know, with my colleagues doing the same, if not even more.
Wow.
Yeah, I've done customer success, onboarding, account management, helped our national accounts division kind of build their offering, which directly supports large multi-location restaurant and retail groups. And now I'm focused on helping merchant service and technology providers better support their portfolio of customers. So, you know, it's been quite the journey. And I guess we like to say there's really never a boring day at Boomtown.
Absolutely. Yeah. Clearly wearing a lot of different hats through your career with Boomtown.
That's what they say.
So for those who may be unfamiliar, and I kind of tried to give a really quick overview, but what exactly does Boomtown do to help ISOs and merchant acquirers? What are you guys doing?
Well, I think it's best to kind of take a step backwards and look at the payments ecosystem as a whole and really the technology revolution that has been going on for over the last decade. And so the world is shifting. It's getting more complex. The payment industry is really no exception to that. And in a few short years, we've moved from a disconnected world to one where everything is connected. So as you mentioned in the intro, you know, devices and API connections in the market have gone from thousands to the trillions. And this has led to an increase in specialization, more integrations, and more points of potential failure. So ISOs and merchant acquirers are technology companies. You know, they're companies that are delivering technology products and services to their customers that allow them to more seamlessly transact with their customers. And so all of this technology, though, needs to be supported. And I think, you know, there's a huge disconnect between the technologies that these organizations can support and what they're being required to support. And so Boomtown exists to solve that key problem. We exist to help technology companies deliver better customer experiences because we believe that's the most important thing an organization can do. There's that one stat. I think it's 5 times more expensive to acquire a new customer than it is to retain an existing one. And really, that gets worse every single day with more and more competition. And so, you know, with ISOs and merchant acquirers, we help with a combination of two things, our software and our services. So our software enables organizations to better support their customers themselves. You know, these are organizations that have support teams, but also are able to use the software to automate some of those support experience. But then also we have a network of technicians to provide field services, and we also do remote services as well. So a managed service component within that. We work with ISOs of all sizes, some small shops with less than 1,000 merchants to large enterprise groups with tens to 100 plus thousand merchants. And it really comes back to the core principle of allowing organizations to specialize in customer support. So dealing with statements, account questions, retention, as opposed to technology support, which they're not experts in. And frankly, a lot of them don't have a desire to be experts in. And so, like I mentioned, we're focused on creating happier customers, which leads to a longer term retention. And ultimately, the goal is, you know, more money.
Absolutely. And I want to highlight what you said there. It's so interesting what you're bringing to the table, because you're almost saying like, we'll handle this for you. We'll take this off your plate so you guys can focus on what you do best. Mm-hmm. You know, you can focus on the customers and growth and all those great things that businesses want. And we'll handle the technology because that's what we're good at.
Yep. Yeah, exactly.
I kind of want to connect this to something that I've seen in payments and we've all been seeing. You know, a lot of ISOs have struggled in recent years to offer products and value that differentiates them from the thousands of other run-of-the-mill merchant service providers. And especially with the rise of these out-of-the-box PayFacs like Square, do you think that these installation and support services can help them competitively when it comes to obtaining customers, new merchants, and things like that? Why or why not?
Yeah, definitely. And I think that there's kind of two ways in which ISOs will need to adopt to truly differentiate themselves. And one of which is continuing to offer better and more technology. So selling a baseline technology or even worse, an ill-fitting solution just to attach processing just doesn't quite cut it anymore. You know, merchants have more options than ever. And so you'd be kind of crazy to think that you'd be able to hold onto that customer for an extended period of time with a subpar solution. But what's also important about that is differentiating the customer journey. So the activation, the support, and the upsell of that. So with activation, utilizing things like white glove installation services and structured training to get merchants activated faster. So we know the longer it takes a merchant to get stood up and trained, the higher your inactivation rates are going to be. And then lastly, you know, offering support. So we're in a world now where 9-to-5 support with 2-hour queues doesn't really cut it. And so,
no.
You know, we offer a 24/7 support operation. And you have those instances where you have a local corner store owner, which is, you know, trying to close out at 2 a.m. Well, your 9-to-5 support offering doesn't necessarily help them. And, you know, I'm not saying that you necessarily have to have a team staffed around the clock, but you can have those answers surfaced up front so your customers can identify the issue that they're having and sometimes potentially self-resolve them.
That is so important to state. We have so many more, you know, new technology coming out. You mentioned earlier how complex things are. So if you're going in and you're looking to onboard a merchant, well, it makes sense to me that if you have a much simpler, painless solution for that merchant, they are going to already feel a lot better about the relationship. You're going to have a much better chance to have a fruitful, long-standing merchant that way.
Yeah, exactly. And that's really what we focus on and is the customer aspect of that journey. Adding new technology to your mix doesn't need to make your business more complicated. You know, it should actually make it more profitable. And that's what we believe in.
Absolutely. So can you talk a bit more about the onboarding process through Boomtown? We just covered how valuable it is. You know, is it designed to just be quick and easy? Because some merchants are really not tech savvy. I've had phone calls with merchants who are really frustrated and they just want to get to their business and they don't want to deal with all sorts of tech issues. Is the process and the software designed to make that a non-issue or less of an issue?
Yeah, definitely. And I'll kind of focus on that last point, which is, you know, how we communicate. So we go back to the values in which we actually founded Boomtown on, which is we speak plainly. You know, we do not speak in tech jargon, which is greatly appreciated by our customers. And then I think second is the utilization of technology to provide that differentiated experience. So we utilize things like web schedulers, which allow merchants to actually sign up and schedule a time that works for them. And then lastly, instead of trying to train them over the phone, we use video training. And I'm not talking just static video recording, which is great in some aspects, but we actually offer live video trainings where we can see what the merchant sees. We literally guide them through each component and answer their questions directly. And, you know, this is the kind of experience where we see engagement rates just skyrocket and really, you know, leads to, again, coming back to the longer retention and a happier customer.
That just makes it so painless. And also, I love that video because you're getting that one-on-one sort of, you know, you can see what they're doing and see where the problems are, see where the hangups are. I think there's a lot of people that, you know, get frustrated if you're on the phone with someone, you've been on hold for forever, and then you're trying to kind of bumble around and they don't really know exactly what you're doing and you don't know what they're trying to get you to do and all that, basically, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Here at SorPay, we have loads of merchants, and managing and communicating with them all can be a challenge. It's not easy to do. What are the keys in your mind to effective customer retention and communication? I'm curious how Boomtown specifically helps ISOs and their agents manage that.
One of the main reasons is that communication has been a challenge is because historically the channels have been fragmented. And so calls come into a different queue than text messages, which come into a different queue than emails and so on. And so we believe that support is more in the channel of your customer's choice, which historically has been a burden, but is now easy. So if we can pull together all of the channels that your customer wants to communicate into a single queue or a single smart inbox, and then utilize things like integrated chat on some of the smart terminals out there, and then start diving into automation. And as I mentioned before, surfacing some of that information up front for your customers to utilize, that's where we see just a more holistic and better experience. And frankly, a much more simple way to communicate with your customers.
Absolutely. And that actually leads me to my other question. You know, I'm so curious from a service perspective to know what kind of communication merchants tend to prefer. For example, here at SOR Payments, we pride ourselves on being able to, you know, we're on the phone, we're available, we can help you out if you have questions or issues. But Boomtown, you've got chat, video, SMS, email, and phone. What's the most popular way? What kinds of benefits do you and ISO see from having so many ways of providing this service to customers?
Yeah, well, I think you're right. And part of it is that, you know, it really depends on where we're at right now. So historically, right, yes, it has been phone, but that's mostly due to it really only being the only viable channel available. And so what we've seen with our tools is actually a huge shift towards chat. And so having a customer utilize web chat to come in and actually communicate with your agents, it's not only efficient from an operations standpoint, your agents can handle multiple communications at one time, but also you bring forth the automation to be able to have your customer self-resolve. And so we actually have an example of a customer where they turned on web chat, and now currently, which was historically a 100% phone queue, they turn on the web chat, and now 30% of that volume is coming through chat. And we've actually been able to self-resolve 50% of those issues just by surfacing the information to the customer. And so, yes, right now in the present day, everyone really was keen on phone, but that's why we're, you know, passionate about what we're doing, is there is a better way. And using technology to solve that is the best route.
Absolutely. Kind of going on to technology, it seems like everyone in business, no matter what you're doing, whether you're in payments or whatever, has had at least one horror story around dealing with technology. And for merchants, a POS not working properly, something on their website breaking a connection between the shopping cart and the gateway, any number of things can be a huge hit to their bottom line if their system's down and they're trying to process transactions. How does Boomtown make this tech support process easy? How do you handle that when you've got a customer that's freaking out because, my POS system's down?
And first off, we see it all the time. But I think it comes back to what I was talking about previously, which is just the general availability of support and, you know, the channels in which you offer support, also paired with the response time in which you give to your customers. And so one of the most common statements we hear is, how can I make it easier to support our customers? As opposed to, how can we make it easier for our customers to get support? And really, they're not mutually exclusive. You can have both. And so if you use the right tools, you can open up your support channels, whether it be chat, SMS, email, phone, and make it easier for your customers to get support, but also using things like automation and the availability of common knowledge to either help your agents find the answers faster or ideally surface that information to the customer and allow them to self-resolve, you know, all of that leads to happier operations leader and a happier customer.
Yeah, if there's a problem with the POS system, and let's say it's just a common problem that a lot of people have run into, and hey, look, there's an FAQ right there online. If it's as simple as the merchant's freaking out, they send a chat, and then boom, here comes the link. Oh, look at that. That's my problem. Okay, I've fixed it. Now I'm processing transactions. That kind of scenario goes way better than someone waiting on the phone for half an hour while they're freaking out and losing sales. Then they get on the phone with an agent and they're yelling because they're stressed out and all that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah, yeah. You sit on hold for a half hour or an hour, and just to have an agent walk you through a three-step process to reset whatever the system is that you're using. It's a little bit of a, you know, antiquated way to view support. And frankly, that's why, you know, again, like I said, we're passionate about the software and being able to enable customers to get a better support experience.
Absolutely. And I just want to underline that for folks listening who might be thinking about their own businesses and how they're all arranged. This is the power. This is the future of it. You know, as a follow-up, how are you able to provide expertise on so many different POS systems, terminals, and gateways? I'm just curious, you know, if something new comes out, do you guys have to get a copy and have your tech team work on learning everything about it? Are you just searching around and trying to find all the resources? How does that work from Boomtown's end?
To be honest with you, we can't expect to be experts in everything. And with that, you know, we are picky with adopting new solutions and focusing on technologies that are more established. And yes, when those relationships first turn on, there is a large information gathering and some legwork that gets put in. But also, our team uses the tools that we built to provide that automated or assistant support experience. So yes, you know, we pride ourselves on that. And essentially, we eat our own dog food. We use the software that we built to provide the support that we pride ourselves on. And so with that, you know, we have a library of agent assist bots gathered and built from all the information that we've gathered from our customers. And that prevents our agents from having to actually scour just pages and pages of knowledge base articles. They can actually go there and chat with these bots in real time and pull forth those answers. And those bots are essentially scraping these knowledge base articles in real time. And so you start to see just the small efficiencies that are gained in an experience like that. When you run, you know, even if you have a small customer support team that's focusing on that all the way to an agent or an agent crew of 50 agents, you can actually see where the efficiencies lie within that.
That's incredible, because one of the things I've noticed, I'm newer to the payments world, you know, I've got about a year under my belt here. And one of the things that everyone in payments says is, hey, it's a complex, you know, there is a lot to learn, there's a lot to know. And even people who have been doing this for 20 years, there's so much they don't even know, and they'll learn something new every day. The fact that you're building a system where technology can help support, you know, an agent, so they don't necessarily have to have everything in their head, but they have a very fast and efficient way to get those answers and then give them to the customer. I mean, that's incredible.
Yeah. And one of those things that you mentioned is key. So when you start looking at building out or having a large support team, there's a huge lag in a new agent starting. Well, first off, I'll back up. There's actually a very large turnover in those support help desks. And then additionally, there's a huge lag in having your agents come up to speed quick enough to actually provide a good support experience. Well, if you're able to use technology to bring forward those answers to your agents, or what we call agent assist bots, then you actually cut that time almost in half. And so you can have an agent come in and within 15 to 30 days, actually have them supporting customers on the front line. You've not only cured the aspect of providing bad support, but you're also getting your agents up to speed quicker and eventually saving money.
Yeah. And I can see how, just from a training perspective, it's easier to train an agent how to use software and use these bots and things like that, rather than try to teach them everything there is to know about whatever the payments technology is or things like that. It's almost a give someone a fish or teach them to fish, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
One of the tricky things that ISOs and acquirers can run into is managing businesses with unique needs. There's so many different types of businesses, and a lot of ISOs work with businesses that might be in completely different industries. How can Boomtown help them navigate when merchants have wildly different needs, inventories, et cetera? Do you guys have tools that specialize for specific industries?
Yeah, well, I think the biggest issue here is that organizations continue to work in silos rather than understand that they are part of a much broader ecosystem. And so utilizing software, which is Relay, and being able to build out the organizations and the ecosystem that you have within your organization, we can utilize the software to intelligently route issues and tickets to the organization or team that would be best suited to resolve that ticket. And then lastly, putting in the framework to be able to pull forth that information to the customer. And again, coming back to, you know, this is common knowledge. Why would we not surface this to our customers and actually allow them to try and self-resolve issues while also, you know, having the ability to stack an agent behind that if they need help?
Absolutely. Okay, do me a favor here, and I need you to peer into the crystal ball.
Okay.
What do you see in the future for Boomtown? Any specific technologies or products on the horizon that you can share that ISOs and acquirers might find to be particularly interesting?
Yeah, well, to kind of give you the whole view is we actually view merchant support as a continuum. That starts with what we're in right now or what you oftentimes see, which is a reactive support experience. So, you know, merchant has an issue, picks up the phone, agent scours articles to help resolve that issue. That's very reactive based off what's occurring. Then we go into what we call assisted, which is the merchant still identifies the issue and picks up the phone, but we're able to arm our team with the agent assist bots to answer those questions faster and kind of cut down on the scouring of those knowledge base articles. The third portion of this is automated, which is, okay, now we're surfacing that common knowledge forward, whether that be through an integrated chat on your website, integrated chat on a smart terminal, or on a cloud-based point of sale system, and actually pulling forward the resolution steps and allowing customers to self-resolve. And then you get into proactive, which is, you know, we actually built an agent that we can put on site or embed in specific technologies that actually proactively alerts us when something goes down. So it doesn't have to wait for someone on site to actually identify that there's an issue. If you have a terminal that drops offline, we're already connected to the network. We're monitoring those devices in real time, and we can actually alert our team in real time if something were to drop offline.
Wow.
Yeah. And then the last thing really is, and I think the holy grail and really what we're working to build here is a predictive support experience. So how can we now leverage the information and the indexing of technologies that we have and utilizing AI and machine learning to actually predict the issues that a merchant or a specific piece of technology are going to have, and then prevent that from ever happening? And so that's kind of the continuum from reactive to predictive that we're really working on building here. And you know, there's a lot of work that comes into getting to that predictive support model, but we're already putting in the, you know, the framework and laying that baseline for this support experience to actually, you know, come to fruition.
Right. So it's the two things. I love that the, you know, predictive versus reactive, and then, you know, just efficiency, just general efficiency. Would you say those are, I mean, is that almost like the umbrella term almost for what you guys are trying to do, is how can we make this support as efficient as possible, and so efficient that in the case where it's like the customer may not even had known that there was an issue just yet, but then it's already resolved or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. And like I mentioned with the proactive view of that, we actually have these agents out in the field right now with existing customers, and some of them are with our large multi-location restaurant retail customers. So if you're a restaurant owner and you have a bar printer or a kitchen printer that drops offline, and you're consistently pushing orders to that kitchen printer and you don't realize that that's offline, that could be disastrous. And so, you know, this is the type of thing that we're solving for every single day, and it's only going to get better and smarter as we continue to give the system more repetitions.
That's incredible. I love that. And that's one of the exciting things, I think, just about payments itself, is how technology can push us forward and make businesses more efficient, more effective, and result for a better experience for everyone, down from, you know, the person there who's just ordered their burger, to the employee who's running the system, to the owner of the business, to the person who has the merchant account, the processor, and things like that, and on and on and on.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
So we have a segment that we like to end with every show, 5 questions, rapid fire. Tyler, are you ready?
Yeah, let it rip.
Make a prediction about the future of payments that you expect will happen in the next 12 to 24 months.
I think there's going to be a continued consolidation in the payment space. And so we're already seeing this, whether it be, you know, large private equity firms that are gobbling up some other larger acquirers or merchant processors, but then also a much broader consolidation of the actual portfolios. And really what that leads to is more competition, so more resources for your competition. And again, kind of comes back to the concept of if you're going to continue to compete, you really need to differentiate yourself. And those two things are, as I mentioned previously, differentiate on the technology that you're providing, and then, you know, the activation and support that you are providing your customer as well.
Absolutely. What's one cool piece of payment-related technology you've come across recently that's unrelated to your company that particularly impressed you?
Well, it's been a couple of years now, but really the new wave of smart terminals. And so, you know, those have just been exploding, especially in the last 8 to 10 months. And there's some really cool products out there. There hasn't been that much innovation in the standard kind of brick terminal in quite a while. And so being able to see tools like Verifone Carbon or Point or the PAX A920, you know, those are really cool products. And they have a great framework built on them where the expansion of what they're going to be able to do and resolve is only going to get exponentially bigger. And so it's really cool to kind of see the evolution of that. And really, I think that there's much bigger things to come from the smart terminals.
I'm looking forward to, as we see, you know, more mass adoption of this, and you go to a restaurant or what have you, and you just see some cool pieces of technology that are enabling you to, you know, pay for your meal and things like that.
Yeah. And with some of those older solutions, you know, pay at the table has been somewhat difficult, but with some of the integrations that are existing now, you can actually bring that and provide that experience at, you know, a sit down restaurant. So you're exactly right.
This just reminds me of a quick little sidebar. A few months back, my wife and I went to this new French bakery here in Chicago, and I had never seen, but all the employees had these, it was a Clover system, and they were carrying it around, and they had it, and it was, they could take your order right there. They could process the transaction right there. It was all seamless, and they all, each employee, each waiter or waitress had their own one. And that's the kind of technology that's just really neat. And, you know, we didn't have to go up and stand in a line to pay and things like that. It was all very seamless.
Yeah, it was probably Clover Mobile or Clover Go.
Yeah, I think that's probably what it was. Yeah.
Really cool products.
In the next 5 years, most Americans will make a purchase with either Bitcoin, Apple Pay, some other thing. Which one and why?
Well, they say cash is king, but I actually think that more broadly, we're going to see a huge expansion in more general NFC payments. So Apple Pay being one of them. But You have Apple Pay, Google Pay, Samsung Pay, which it was a pretty interesting product. But, you know, really focusing on those NFC products, how they're integrating into, you know, some of the systems and wearables. Like, for instance, I have an Apple Watch on right now that has Apple Pay integrated. If I go on a run and run down the street, you know, I don't want to carry my wallet or, you know, a credit card. Why would I not have that loaded up on my wrist, essentially, and be able to pay for that? And so I think people were expecting it to take off a little bit quicker than they have. You've seen some of the other competitors of Apple Pay and Google Pay and Samsung Pay, you know, kind of fall by the wayside. And you've also seen some acquisitions in that. But, you know, I think the NFC payment space is really just going to expand, and kind of look forward to it as well.
I agree. And it's all about adoption. And then what have we been talking about this whole episode? Efficiency.
Yep.
You know, you can go for a run, and then, you know, if you say, you know what, I'm really thirsty and I want a smoothie or something, you can just go and boom, get your smoothie and finish it and head on home. And you never had to worry about carrying a clunky wallet around. That's great.
Yeah, exactly.
What's one piece of advice you would have for someone who's considering the payments or tech industry in payments as a career?
Yeah, don't. No, I'm just kidding. Well, really, as you mentioned before, there is a lot to it. There's a lot of complexity, but it's also very rewarding. And, you know, it comes back to kind of the way that I found myself in it is Boomtown was founded on the principle of enabling local merchants and giving them the type of resources to operate as you would, you know, a big box retailer or a large multi-location restaurant. And so, you know, if you carry that passion of local businesses drive our economy and the payments are how those local businesses continue to grow, I think, and you carry that passion, I think you'll find a very rewarding career in payments. And really, I recommend diving in head first and get your feet wet, and you'll come out of it very knowledgeable, but also you'll find a very rewarding career.
What's the best business advice you've ever received, and from whom?
Well, it's actually a great friend of mine, Giuseppe Marzelli. He's the best salesperson I've ever met, and it's always keep it moving. Its simplicity is key, and, you know, I think it's kind of understated in the world that we see today. So with that, best business advice, just always keep it moving.
I love it. And to end with the simplicity is key. I mean, it sounds like if there's a takeaway from what you guys are doing at Boomtown, that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to bring all these complex systems and things that can be inefficient and get people hung up. And you're trying to make it simple and easy. And then that results in a better experience for everyone, top to bottom, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Tyler, I wanted to thank you so, so much for joining me on the show today. This was really informative and really interesting. Some incredible things you guys are doing over there.
Thanks, Scott. Really appreciate it and love the podcast. You know, I've listened to quite a few of them now and really look forward to seeing you guys continue to grow as well.
Oh, appreciate it. And if folks are listening and they want to learn more about you guys and connect, where should they go?
Yeah, well, you can obviously come to our website, goboomtown.com. You can find us on Twitter. You can find us on Facebook, or you can just come into thinkrelay.com and chat it with us directly. As I mentioned, whatever channel you want to come, we'll talk to you.
You guys are there. Love it. Thanks again so much, Tyler.
Of course. Thank you.
So that completes our show today. Thanks so much for listening. And don't forget to subscribe if you like the show. You can do so on iTunes, Google Play, and many other platforms. So until next time, I'll see you then. And thanks again for listening.
Thank you for listening to another episode of PayPod, brought to you by Soar Payments. Soar Payments is a leading merchant services provider for e-commerce, high-risk, and hard-to-place businesses. If you'd like to get the latest PayPod episode sent to you automatically, subscribe to the show via iTunes or Stitcher, or visit soarpay.com/podcast.